Number one, thanks for coming out on a lovely day like today. And I'm happy to see you all here, as a matter of fact. So Tanya and I will be doing some different things. And I'm Roger Sharmer, Tanya Kabbalah. And we are here basically to walk the route and also learn more about the area. And so, you know, starting at the end, we started out with Bob Wesley's wonderful rendition of Indian trails. And then we get into Ferryville. Ferry family's a fascinating story. They start out in Massachusetts, and then he's a missionary, he's a theological school guy. He's sent to Mackinac Island to educate the people, etc. And he's there for basically about 11 years. And then, as teachers know, they burn out and you do something else. And so he came down the Grand River from Detroit and thought, he who controls the Grand River probably has a pretty good setup. And so he founded Grand Haven. Then they went across the river and founded Ferrysburg. And then their son Noah came up here, and basically they then laid out Ferryville. And they ran out of ferry names by the time they got to Montague, and so they named it after Reverend William Montague Ferry, and that's where the Montague gets its name. And that plat was 1867. So, and then there's one more ferry hit, which is sort of east of New Era, and it's called Ferry. And so you can see the evolution of, you know, the mill, because obviously it starts out with the outlet. There was a bed of clay, marl, all right? And so what happens is that as, it's interesting, this is where the river used to come out, White River, all right? And now this is closed off, so the whole current is reversed and kind of goes this way and comes out the new channel the other way. But anyway, as it washed out here, it ran over this bed of marl, which is white. And so there's this big white blur, like if you were Father Marquette, which the arrows there show where Father Marquette went. He actually died in Ludington. This was like one of the last hits. I was joking with Bob and Jamie that somehow, after spending the day at Lloyd's Landing, he went on to Ludington to end it. Okay, anyway. You can see where the old mill was on the land side. And then this thing, the White River Barrier Dunes has always sort of been a barrier dunes. And there's a wonderful booklet. They sell these at the Montague Museum. Historical Society sells them at Celebrate White Lake, and it's basically a story. So this is called The Deserted Village, White River, 1837. It starts out that somehow there's a stump, and so they leave mail and stuff like that in a stump, supposedly. That's where the name Stumpville comes from. And then you'll see the sign out there that says White Haven. Well, Grand Haven is the Grand River, and obviously White River is White Lake, so this is called White Haven. And so this area here has always been referred to as White Haven. And then you'll see names like Knudsen, which actually is a name that blurs into the Pitkin family ultimately, but the Knudsens also signed the village plat with the Ferry family for the city of Montague in 1867. Then there's some wonderful photographs here just showing, you know, the steamships coming in, the water in the bayou, the logs in the bayou. Moving on down, you see remnants of the old Ferryville plat. And then you get down here more into the lumbering activity. You can kind of see this is where maybe the old channel end is located, the lumber barges. I wore a shirt with the Ellen Wood, which is an old Flagstaff boat, Captain Flagstaff's boat, supposedly on the antenna or the weather vane. And then the 1860 survey, Lee Holly from the other side of the lake got very interested in this, and so he arranged to have somehow the old plat superimposed over the existing. It's a little off, but somehow does kind of tell the story. And then we end up down here, where you can kind of see the remaining portion of the bayou, the old channel, which would have gone out like that. And then we're down here with the barrier dunes, and this is the White River Sanctuary, Barrier Dune Sanctuary. And then the Gazan property is outlined in red. And then the different parcels. And it's interesting what happened was that these parcels up on the hill all had access, physical access, off Lau Road, all right? And so there's names that you run into down here. There's Hamilton, Weber, and Lloyd. And it's a wonderful trilogy of entanglement, etc. And so you have these strips of land, which basically they just use, the people on the bluff use them for access to Lake Michigan. And sometimes they had a kayak, a canoe. They, if you kayak up at the old channel today, you'll see some little bridges that go across to the dune land, etc. And then when they put the new channel in, basically this made this channel obsolete. As I mentioned, the water direction flowed the other way, the Pearson Drain or Sedonia Bayou. Then to bring us up to date today, we're now here. And so Ferry Street, Lloyd, there's another map I should have brought along, which was, it showed kind of a 1930s, 1940s map, and it showed Lloyd Park, which Bob can tell you more about the family kind of thing, where they basically, Lloyd's Landing, Old Channel Inn, the corner store, designated a parkland. It shows up on maps. Paul Medbury, the old city clerk, was a map maker also. And Medbury Park is named after him down at the old down at the new channel. But anyway, so Lloyd Park was here also. But anyway, then this is the Barrier Dunes. And as we all know and we'll discover when we walk through, that basically the dunes are alive. They're constantly moving, they're constantly shifting, they blow, the weather does this, the wind does that, the plant vegetation holds something or doesn't hold something. And you know, the old channel goes up, it goes down, etc. So it's very much alive, and the intent was of the White River Barrier Dunes was basically to have this as a sanctuary and remain untouched, etc. And that now there's, you know, the plans for the road to be bulldozed to the dunes, and after different offers have been made to the applicant, Brogy, about to buy or not to buy, or to sell or not to sell. So that's kind of the quick rundown. I'm going to take this thing to the meeting also on Monday night, because I think it'd be kind of educational for a lot of people to see.
Question?
Yes.
Is that an accurate representation where it goes from Ferry Street all the way down to the channel, the new channel road?
No, this only goes down to basically where the Kazan property would be located.
Okay, that's not.
This is an easement done in 1986. Okay. Don Sandell was a surveyor. Bob, did you have any further things on this one?
That really doesn't depict the Kazan property too well. There were two Hamiltons that were going to sell at the time that the trust agreement was made, and the one backed out, Sheldon Hamilton backed out. And so that is the result of the Kazan property now.
Right.
And the intent was that at some point in time, the township would buy that.
Right.
To complete the dune sanctuary. By the time they would do that, it was sold.
Okay.
And I don't know, it sold a few times, didn't it?
Well, it was sold to Parkland Development, which was Kazan and Rooks.
Right.
And then Brooks transferred it or sold it to Kazan.
Bob Kazan.
And Tara Jackson Kazan.
Right, his wife, okay.
And then they, in a forced sheriff sale, Earl G picked it up.
Oh, okay.
And then maybe, I got it in the car, I can't remember which year, but.
Yeah.
That
Earl G, are those any of the Kazans? Or
all three.
Yeah, it's all three. Okay, so really it hasn't changed too far ahead.
No. They haven't been, they had their fingers in it the whole time.
Yeah, it's kind of confusing.
Yeah, because that is.
Then also, is there something like any price tags on the property first time around, second time around?
What, I'm sorry?
You mean on the purchase that was offered?
Yeah, right.
It was upwards of $800,000 for it.
It was in the paper somewhere.
Okay.
But they want over $1 million for it?
They wanted 1.4.
Okay, the last time, which was maybe 5 or 6 years ago?
At one time, Bob Kazan and Tara Jackson gave Richard Brolick an option on it for $175,000.
Okay.
And then Brolick couldn't get access to it, so Bob Kazan had to pay him back $175,000. He didn't have it, so his brother stepped in and took it over. That's the sale.
That's what they paid.
So it's $175,800. I got involved with, I belong to the Michigan Botanical Society, and so we had these handouts for a shoreline walk we did from Goodridge Park over to Ellenwood when they were sort of redoing the shoreline, so to speak. And And so I would encourage you all, because there's something like, pick up a copy of that and before we go on the walk, and there's basically a plan. You can pass the whole thing around, as a matter of fact, yeah.
There are five tickets for $20 or $5 a piece. There's going to be one more of the photographs on canvas, but there's the four photographs on canvas and then the oil painting. I took the photographs, my sister did the painting. But we're hoping to raise at least $2,000, and all of that goes to save the dune.
What is the money used for in the fund?
Probably to pay attorney fees. I'm going to guess that we're going to have some attorney fees.
Yeah, it's 24 foot wide, and then they would pave 12 foot. But call it a road, not a driveway.
It's a road.
Where do they want it to go?
Do you see where the stakes are? See Steve up there? See the orange flags? See the colored flags? It's a 20, they've marked out 24 feet and then, oh, that's not Steve, sorry. Greg, okay. Anyway, it's a 24 foot and then they would pave 12 feet.
And we're supposed to call it a road instead of a drive.
And I will tell you why later, but yes, it is not a driveway. But that would cross straight through the Doom Preserve.
It reminds me of that is not a chocolate factory. That is not a driveway.
That is not a driveway. And that's very important from the law's perspective. And I'll wait for these folks to come up. I'm going to talk to you first just a little bit about what makes Dune so special. It's, you know, most of you would probably agree it's one of the state's top natural assets. There's 275,000 acres on Lake Michigan and Lake Superior shorelines. That's not all critical dunes. I'll talk about critical dunes later. There are dunes all over the place. These are not the only dunes. But what's neat about these dunes is that it's the largest collection of dunes on a freshwater resource. Lake Michigan. So that's really internationally acknowledged. They also, our dunes I think are pretty neat too, and sometimes people from other states or other countries come here and they're like, wow, you've actually got wooded dunes. And you know, a lot of the dunes you see in other places are like bare sand dunes, like the desert. And what's neat about ours is they have four distinct zones, and not all areas have these zones and have them in the same way, but the beach. The next is where the dune is growing. That's the fore dune. That's where you see the marum grass that needs to be covered in order to grow, and maybe a few shrubs and, you know, starting to be a little bit more plants and trees. Then often you'll have a low area, which is called an interdunal trough, which is very special because it, you know, it's a little wetland area, which is a totally different setting than the beach or the fore dune. And then you will have the oldest dunes is usually the back dunes, and that's the forested dunes. So you have these four distinct settings, and you have different plants and animal species that use different, and then you have plants, you have animals that actually use the entire dune system for everything. So it's really quite a unique system. It's actually the birth of ecology. That's called succession, how one natural setting kind of builds into another, and Henry Chandler Coles came up with that, and that's kind of the birth of the science or the field of ecology from the dunes. He did that mostly in the Indiana dunes. So what's interesting about this entire dune system, and there's also a lot of endangered and threatened species. There's some that just live in Great Lakes dunes, Houghton's goldenrod, Pitcher's thistle, which these dunes do have. What's interesting about this whole system is it's a little bit different. Basically, your trough area is probably most likely the creek, and your back dune is probably what's been built on. You know, so you've got four dunes on this side, so it's a little bit different than some of the more typical dune systems. They were created as a result of the last ice age, which ended about 10,000 years ago. Most of the dunes in our area are about 5,000 years old. And if they're gone, and there are a lot of them already gone to mining or development, not going to come back in our lifetime or our children. So I would consider them to be irreplaceable. So any questions before we move on to that unique tree? Yes. Harold, sorry.
How far is the easement going?
The Dune Preserve is approximately from here 1,000 feet. And then I always forget how wide it is. How wide is it?
24 foot.
What is it?
435 feet.
Yeah, and basically the road would have to traverse the entire preserve because it's at the end of the preserve that is the landlocked property. It would have to go through that entire, and you'll notice that it would have to go over some considerably high slopes, and that's...
They can't come in from the other end.
I've been told that they have tried to find southern access, but have not been given the okay by property owners. Bob, do you know anything about trying any access from the south side?
Yes, they tried that, and the landowners there, Baker Hamilton, when he put these easements in, purposely stopped them on the, what we call the clay property, and what's now the Gazan property.
Okay.
He didn't want a through road going all the way through. So they stop right there. To come in from the south, they would have to get permission from private property owners, and they're not about to get it.
Yeah, that's kind of what I've been told.
Who owns this?
The township.
Why does that require permission, but to come across this land doesn't?
Well, because those didn't have easements.
Oh, there is an easement.
There is an easement here.
That doesn't help.
And at the...
Yeah, actually, Bob's going to explain, like, where they are going to... Go ahead, Bob. Give this...
I walked this with the surveyors and Phil Johnson, which is the project manager for... They're going to try and bury the 12 feet within the 24, so they miss a lot of things. He said they would definitely miss that tree. Whether that's true or not, I don't know. That's what
accidents
he told me.
Happen.
What?
Accidents happen.
Yeah, they do.
Even if they get close to the tree, it could damage it, though, because of the root system.
But if they do put a tree there, they're going to have heavy trucks coming through there.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
With big loads on it.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to damage the trees regardless.
Yeah. Well, there's going to be a lot of damage. The turning it'll fan out from that stake that you see, the hard one, and the one that's in the trees to the left, and then it'll fan out 50 feet.
So why?
Because they have to be able to turn to get in.
Is this for their car or the construction
trusses?
So rather than a 90-degree turn, it's going to have a shallow
curve. It'll fan out.
Now, I haven't heard anything about emergency access, and I didn't notice any plans for that.
Now they're talking about that they may have to expand it to 20 feet in order for a fire truck.
Okay, so that's even worse than the 12 feet.
The sewer, the utilities are going to be underground, the electric, and the whatever else they want to run, cable TV or whatever. There's 6-inch pipes, and my brother John may know more about that.
Yeah, because they can't do any more than a 45-degree turn in that length to make it. And that's why they proposed eventually parking lots so they could get down and move stuff
out of there. So they've got two parking lots planned, maybe one up here and one at the end?
Well, one in the middle.
Oh, one in the middle, okay.
But that's not their land.
They don't show that on there.
No, they don't.
What about the sewer?
They have an approved septic.
Well, the sewer is going to be septic.
That's already approved.
Yeah. So there's going to be a septic field there.
There's like 3,000 gallon tanks.
Both those have been approved by the health department.
Where are the wetlands in here?
The when I talked about the inundable trough, my guess is, from talking to Jeff Alk, is that it's more likely that the creek itself is serving as that low area, and that most likely that the back area that's been built up was the original back dune.
Sedoni Road.
Well, actually, the houses on the other side of the creek along there are probably in the back dune, built in the back dune.
Because I heard some folks at White River Township talking about putting a bridge for part of the building, and I want to know where that is.
Part of the
there's
building?
There's a bridge, there's a wetland, and the wetland takes special permission.
I don't know anything about that, Margo.
I've seen the site plans. There's no bridge on the site.
No.
Not for that.
And they don't have, if we travel down this way, there's no wetlands. There's no wetlands. We're going to go down to the unusual tree and stop again. Okay. Part of the challenge is that people are allowed to build on the dunes. I mean, we have not disallowed development on the dunes. You know, and I'm not saying that's the problem, but I'm just saying, just keep in mind, and maybe even people here have homes in the dunes, but there are restrictions to, you know, for the most environmentally sensitive, fragile dunes. Critical dunes. I mentioned that we have 275,000 acres of dunes on Lake Michigan, Lake Superior. 70,000 of those are in a smaller group that we've called critical dunes. And most of you might be familiar with the fact that in 1976, the state passed a law relating to mining in the dunes. And that just allowed for permitting and things like that to happen with mining. Didn't do a whole lot in my estimation. In 89, however, that original law was changed to reflect the fact that there was a lot of concern about building in the dunes. You know, the lakeshore probably originally had a lot of small cottages, kind of small footprints. You know, in the 70s, 80s, lakefront properties getting more exciting and more interesting to live on, and so people are buying cottages and putting big mansions up. And so a lot of the concerns were fragmentation of habitat, you know, just big lopping off the top of the dune, putting big houses. So in 89, under Governor Blanchard, the law was amended to call a small set of dunes, the most fragile, environmentally sensitive dunes. Scientists termed these dunes, came up with a critical dune atlas. Critical dunes, and then you needed to work with the Department of Environmental Quality on how to build in those dunes. It was not tremendously popular with property owners, but it was actually a law that was supported by both parties, and for a long time was supported by both parties. And my take on this is that because of term limits, we lost a lot of these people with a lot of institutional knowledge, because the law really was not up for grabs until we lost a lot of that knowledge on both sides of the aisles. Actually, we probably need to look at this critical dune map atlas again, because in 1994, scientists looked at it and said, you know what? We didn't really include all the critical dunes that we needed to. They suggested adding 12,000 more acres. This is both public and private. And the state legislature said, no way. So that's something to think about. One of the things, dunes are a dynamic system. You know, change is natural and it has to happen. The problem with development is that it's the dunes can't really recover from some of the intense construction activities. They're degraded when their vegetation is removed. Construction in the dunes can change the light. It can change like little microclimates. When you stop the movement of the sand in the dunes, which development does, you change everything. Or you can restart dormant processes. You know, for example, if you do development in the back dunes, you know, you can kind of start that sand moving again. So, you know, development really, you know, is a big change to the dune system. The biggest one problem with development in the dune is fragmentation. When you cut the landscape up into smaller and smaller pieces, and aerial photos of the dunes show that this is already happening. And so that just really causes a lot of problem with the plant and the wildlife species. So that's kind of it for critical dunes.
Is this a critical dune?
This is a critical dune. Yes, this is a critical dune. Generally, the barrier dunes, the tallest, closer to the lake, tend to be those dunes, but you can actually, I can probably find it online, there's actually a critical dune atlas. You can look and see, you know, different counties. It's a little tricky though, because, you know, to know actually down to the property line, you'd have to look at a different map than the one that's online. Roger.
Yeah, I think, you know, as we walk through here, like, I'm just looking over here, you know, if you go on the other side of that dune, there'll be a sand blow, all right? The sand is scooped up and it's constantly shifting and moving. And so you know that somehow, you know, fragile is the word, that somehow, you know, all through here, where is the road going to go? How are they going to do it? What is the effect on the dunes? And so as you go, you know, try to envision where the road would do and what it would do. And we all know how sand slopes, like Beach Street down in Pere Marquette, in Michigan, Muskegon, they end up closing, you know, portions of it during the winter because, you know, the front yards are all basically sand and it's constantly moving. So like, if you're going to give testimony like tomorrow to the DEQ hearing, you know, the fragile quality of the dunes.
Well, and another, and I'm going to give some points right before we end on some points to make in your testimony, but the other thing is that this is a relatively small dune property. You know, to have that size of a road go, you know, bisect the entire property is you know, very significant.
How big is this dune?
What's the total size?
12 by 1,200 feet long, but I don't know.
Like 400. So. Yeah. You know, but it's, okay. You know, it would be different if you had thousands of acres on a road through that. You know, you're not going to be impacting that system to the degree that you're impacting this. I'm actually going to take us to the next stop, and you'll be able to see what's called an active dune system, and I'll be able to talk about why there's problems going through that. What was your question?
There's a pink thing over there. Is that
yes.
the west boundary of this easement that they
want? We're thinking that's the west boundary of the easement. And
well,
so
this tree
if you can,
would go then.
What?
This tree would go.
Well, they're going to try and go to the Phil Rogers said, I've climbed this tree, my kids have climbed this tree, the botanist he had with him has climbed the tree. We all love the tree, we're not going to take it.
The difference, we've got critical dune is a small group of the bigger dune system. One difference is you need a permit to do something in critical dunes versus in the larger dune system. It's the dunes that a group of scientists, when the law was passed, determined these are the ones that we think we need to protect out of the entire system because they're more environmentally fragile and sensitive. And that's more a scientist question. They have their criteria that they're checking off as they're looking at the dune system.
Does a permit, is that necessary if they have the easement?
Yes.
Even though the easement exists, in order to improve the easement, in order to get to the property, you need a permit.
Okay.
Because there are in the law, there are things that you can't do to somebody else's property to critical dunes if it's public property.
I think the tenants of the DNR trust fund monies that was used to buy it means it cannot be developed. And if it's developed, the township has to repay the money to the DNR.
I don't know. I know that there've been a lot of questions about the easement and about, you know, the easement that was in the private properties and then in the township, and that's something probably for lawyers.
This is the first test case of this law.
Yeah, although they've had the easement and they've applied for permits before and they've been turned down, so.
Are there other properties privately owned?
Beyond them. Right?
Beyond this?
But they have access from the other side.
So they don't have an easement.
They don't have an easement
so
through them.
So there's no access for them to drive
it. Right.
So this would open up for everybody else as well.
No.
No, they can get it from the south.
They can get it from the south side. They don't need this. They didn't need it. We're going to go on to one more place and walk to get warm.
That's a good idea.
Bird. Actually, the easement, it continues along there. I wanted us to look here, though, because what's interesting about this parcel and this part of the preserve is this is what's called an active dune area. And you'll notice, in a way, it looks really more like a foredune that you would see right along the beach. So, but it's the area that provides the greatest value to the dune system because it has the greatest diversity. And it needs to have sand movement continue. So once you do something in a type of a dune area like this that stabilize it, you're going to be losing that diversity of plant species. You know, this is where you have the marum grass that needs to be buried, you have the red osier dogwood, I think that's the red over there. This is an active dune area, and that's a big challenge for putting in a structure that's going to stabilize it, because then you're going to speed up nature's timetable. Then you're going to end up over time with a forested back dune that's happened a lot sooner, but you're also going to be losing a lot of ecological value. So we're going to keep going this way. Any questions?
The road
is over there.
Are we coming back that way?
Yes, we're coming back that way. Yeah. No, but keep in mind that the road is crossing an active dune area. But this is a good example of an active dune area. I wanted to talk a little bit here about the law that I mentioned was passed in 89. And basically that law was not intended to halt building in the critical dunes, but basically you needed to get a permit, and the idea would be your construction activities and your building would be placed on the dune property in the best place for not only your own safety, but for the dune's health. And so it was not designed to halt development If you look at the statistics, it didn't do that. But like I said, still, it was not a very popular law with some people, and there were changes over time for variances and special exception. And the primary piece of the law that was implemented, that is, if you had a slope more than 33%, you couldn't build on that. You know, so the goal was to find some place on your property where you wouldn't be impacting that that slope. Then in 2012, August 2012, very surprising and quick, amendments were made to the Sand Dune Act, and I was particularly annoyed at this because there were two groups that pushed it that I'd been on a committee with for several years. About 3 years in a row, there were the state, the Department of Environmental Quality set up a committee of environmentalists and different folks, developers, to look at the law, and there'd been some questions about it relating to takings and things like that, and quite an eye-opening thing to see some of the folks on there and their different viewpoints of dunes. The two primary strong men in the deal were Michigan Association of Realtors and Michigan Association of Home Builders. We met for 3 years, got to the point where it, and I was actually pushing for the law to be more broad rather than just looking at slope, looking at more, the entire ecological piece. We were working with scientists. It became very clear that the environmentalists had reluctantly given on a couple of things. Yeah, you can have some, go ahead, do utility work and things like that. And we were not going to get what we wanted. Most of us kind of backed out. And last summer, the Michigan Association of Realtors Home Builders Group went to some legislators and said, we want to change the law. And actually, it's the consensus of this group that was meeting for 3 years, the group that I was on. So it was really quite disheartening to see that. And so some of the legislators may have really thought that this was a consensus opinion. You know, everybody wanted this, and it was pushed through very fast. And the governor, really just a lack of understanding of the law. And
did any local legislators vote for it?
We were able to muster, opposition from our end. Representative Holly Hughes voted no. Senator Jeff Hansen voted no. You know, and it's likely that they know this area really cares about dunes and their environmental, so, they were able to do that. The changes do make it easier for driveways. That was one thing that was really on developers' minds, was let's get these driveways made easier. Also, reduces public involvement. I don't think it's a huge big deal ultimately, but used to be if I worked for an environmental group, I could request a public hearing if I didn't live within 2 miles. Now, to me, it really smacks of trying to get the public interest groups who care about the dunes out of the process.
So it's got to be people who live
within 2 miles.
Who have ownership, property ownership.
Yes.
Well, doesn't the OF be ownership, does it? You just have to live within 2 miles.
You have to live within 2 miles of the applicant.
Yeah, yeah.
Which, realistically, I don't think that's going to be a huge big deal. But
that's a call for a hearing, right?
To call for a public hearing. But on the other hand, sometimes if you look at the past, it was likely public interest groups that were calling for these hearings, raising it to the attention of the neighborhood, and that's eliminated. They speed up the time. And this is a real problem because the DEQ staff, they are already strapped for time and resources, and now there's a time clock. If they don't make a decision in a certain amount of time, it's automatically approved.
No.
Yeah. And in addition to... Well, we actually have that with wetlands permitting too, which I think is really bad, and it's, certainly, on the behalf of the person who wants to, do something in the wetland or the dunes. The other piece of that is really challenging, and I'll read this. A permit shall be approved unless the local unit of government or the department, the DQ, determines the use will significantly damage the public interest or the privately owned land, or if the land is publicly owned, the public interest in the publicly owned land by significant and unreasonable depletion or degradation of any of the following. The diversity of the critical dune areas within the local unit of government, the quality of the critical dunes, within the local unit of government, and the functions. And basically, the township, for example, or the Department of Environmental Quality has to document with scientific information. The burden of proof is on them to say, this is how you're going to harm the dunes. So you add that to the fact that you've got this quick timetable, you know, for the department. You add that, you know, the burden of proof, a fairly high and almost unrealistic burden of proof, is going to be on, you know, people like you and I in the township. That to me, I'm hoping is going to be overturned, because it's just not workable.
The whole scientific background evidence that was used to create the Critical Dune Act, is that going to play into this decision at all? Or
well, that's
how?
A good point. You're asked if the scientific information used for to designate this a critical dune area. You would think so, but on the other hand, even though scientists said these are the most fragile and sensitive, basically what it does is it requires a permit. So it doesn't say that you can't do something. And one of the challenges, I think, in Michigan is that the state of science on dune ecology is pretty low. We're very fortunate to realize that in the last probably 10 years, we've got 3 dune scientists, one at Aquinas, one at Hope, one at MSU, and they do different things. But there's not a lot of research out there that we can use for this type of a project, you know, as far as documenting, you know, the damage. And so the burden of proof is unreasonably high, in my opinion. One of the things I thought about, though, is I thought, okay, if you're applying to the trust fund to put this into a preserve status, you're going to have to show that it has some significant natural resource value, right? Wouldn't that be enough? You know, that the trust fund approved this, you know, grant to the township to set this up. You know, because I don't think the trust fund gives money to properties that have little or no ecological value. So that might be something to consider.
Okay, so here we are. We're going through the critical dune step. So what's going to happen? Okay. This is the north line of the Gazan property there. I think we should walk down to the south line, because basically it's 100 feet, right, Bob?
200 feet.
200 feet down. Okay.
Just know you're trespassing, though, right?
Well, so is he.
I just want to point that out.
The easement basically is over there, all right? So they then are going to build, there's two septic, Bob has the plans, he can show you back at the garage, etc. There's two septic systems that go in at the end of the easement. The easement stops here, all right, at the 200 feet of the Gazan property. Then there's basically a basement and a two-story house on top of that, hopefully enough to view out over the dunes, etc. So it's very significant. And then, you know, there's the house behind, which will then look at a house down here. And, you know, it was always the intent, basically, that this was like a no man's land, and that those parcels, those people would walk over to, that was their 50-foot strips, and that's what that map shows back at the garage kind of thing, that somehow you just walk across it. And so, and the other thing is that I think, at the hearing or whatever, you know, this in my youth, okay, we would come down here, ride a bicycle down here, some buddies, etc., you would camp out with sleeping bags and stuff like that. And that somehow, there's Lloyd's Landing at this end, where there was a park at one time. Now there's a sanctuary dunes. And then there's Medbury Park, 600 feet, owned by the city of Montague at the other end, all right? So it's always been a connected, and there's never really been any houses out here until Gazan started building the big baby, you know, north of the channel kind of thing. And so this is always, it's always almost been like, this is, Hamilton's had this, you know, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. And then she finally dies at 100-something, and then that's when the ownership start changing. And so basically, it was fallow land forever. I mean, it was like just a no-man's land. And so it's just it's always been assumed to be public land, but really, it was a lot of different private ownerships, but there was never anything, you know, like keep out private property, that sort of thing.
One thing to keep in mind, though, Roger, I took some folks from the Michigan Environmental Council out here, and they said, looking at the slopes for the property, it's likely that they would, and I'm not saying this is 100% sure, that, you know, the issue is more likely with the easement through the high slopes versus the property, where they're not going to have the high slopes to deal with through a residence. So it may not be an, you know, the slope issue may not be an issue with building the residence itself because of where they're choosing to build. They're not building on a more than 1-3 slope. So it's got to, you know, and I can mention a few more things, because I think we'll have Bob and Roger take us back that way. But what I wanted to make as far as comments at the hearing would be, if you can, written and oral comments are best. It's very helpful for the department to have your written comments. So if you have a chance to write up comments, that's really valuable. And then I would suggest not going and reading them, but maybe summarizing them. Read them if you have to, but not if it's two or three pages long.
There's a time limit.
Yeah. But what I have found from my experience is that written and oral are really helpful, because then they have exactly what you want to say. And you might forget what you want to say when you get up there and have a few things. So written and oral are good. Strong, positive, passionate, as much as possible, though they're going to be looking for information that relates to their permit decision making. So it doesn't hurt to say we love the dunes, they're important, and we support White River Township. But the more that we can add in there things that actually will go to their decision making, the better. Because they can't make a decision just when we say dunes are great. You know, that's not gonna, they can't make that and get away with it. The other thing is I think an important, and you all know this, but sometimes people get kind of annoyed at the developer and, you know, sometimes negative and personal, and that probably doesn't work, just, you know, unless you're in a group of friends and you're venting, so, and you're frustrated.
What she's saying is don't call him an SOB.
Exactly.
We were told not to even mention his name. He used to be called the applicant.
Exactly.
And,
yeah.
And you to always mention road.
It's a road.
It's
not
a road, exactly. Not a driveway.
That's the it's other point. It's a road. Don't ever even say the word driveway. But that also is that there might be other people looking, and sometimes, you know, when you're more objective, you're more effective. I think one of the first points to say is this application isn't even complete. Why are you even having a public hearing on an application that's not complete? You know, basically, the applicant calls the road through a dunes a driveway, which it's not. Driveways are defined in the Act as from the property boundary to the residence. And there's a bias for approval.
It's entirely within
their
the
own
boundary
property.
Of the private
exactly.
land.
Which would be from right here to
on
the house.
His property. That's what a driveway is, from the boundary of his property to where he needs to get to the garage. Now a road, however, cannot cross slopes more than 1 and 3 without a special exception. And so if you look at the easement, Bob, he's crossing slopes that are more than 1 and 3.
Oh, yeah, there's tons of them.
Tons of them. If the road is going to cross high slopes, which it does, beyond a certain degree, then he has to ask for a special exception. And he didn't do that. That should have been in his application. He should have identified, he didn't even identify this as township property. He actually said the entire project was in his own control.
No.
Yes. So basically, if he had identified this as township property and a road that had to go through it with more than the high slope in the law, he would have had to ask for a special exception. Now, I'm not positive, but one reading of the law is that with a special exception, the township can go, no.
If the township designated this as a park, would that hold more sway?
I don't know. Part of the problem is you really can't change what you've done with the preserve right now when there's an application.
Because well, for future.
For future,
it's
yes.
called a sanctuary.
Although Joanne told me they can't call it a sanctuary anymore. It's a dune preserve. That's what Joanne said.
Nice. Why?
I don't know. Something related to the federal government. That's all. So I've just been calling it a dune preserve.
Has he done this before?
It doesn't matter what we call it. As long as the easement's there, we have a problem.
Yeah, exactly.
Three times before.
And I think...
How did he fight it? How did they lose? Was there...
First time the slope was too high. The second time the applicant could not show three clear titles.
Well, you said three times. He's tried three times here, or is he's built in three other dunes
here?
No,
he's tried three times.
What was the third time? I thought the first time. See, now this is another point to make. Is, you know, 1994 he applied to run, and they said no, slope's too high. Nothing's changed.
No, this slope's still too high.
What was the third time, Bob?
The third time was no clear title. The second time was when they seated a jury of neighbors and asked for access rights.
Oh, okay. So
and they denied him.
Okay, so they weren't trying to go through the township. They were trying
right.
to go, okay, I got that. So one, a very important point to make is the road will seriously damage, destroy the preserve. And you can talk about how you walked it and you could see that road is going to bisect the preserve and it will change, you know, remove the, you know, the highest ecological value of the preserve. It's going to need long-term maintenance. It's also going to affect the creek as far as sedimentation, erosion,
They'll have to plow it in the wintertime.
Yeah, yeah. So it's not only going to be an immediate short-term effect, it's going to be a long-term effect. But I would also say that, you know, the way that the law has changed so that the burden of proof is on the township like us is unreasonable. You know, we should be coming up with scientific information to, you know, to show why this is not possible. You know, taking a walk up and down the Dune Preserve tells you why right there, so.
I'd like to find out also, like, we cut through the trees over here. There's kind of like a local story that we interviewed Les Brand, who lived up on the hill. Tracy Dobson now has the property. They had a 50-foot easement going across it. And that the old original, Dr. Hamilton, paid Les Brand like a dollar a tree, or I don't know, 10 cents a tree or something, to plant these trees here, all right, the evergreen trees. And when we were working that Yacht Club book, History of White Lake Tourism, et cetera. And so if you look at the trees, you'll notice that the trees, half of them, you know, they're buried. The first 4 feet are buried kind of thing. And that somehow, you know, the trees are basically holding some of the landscape, et cetera. And just, you know, observe the trees and how wide the root is without any kind of, you know, the roots are like another 4 feet down or another 4 feet down.
He's taking out 83
trees. He has to remove 83 shrubs. Of course, he's going to replace them one-to-one, but still.
Oh,
sure. Wait, thanks for your interest and hope you can show up on Monday. And if
find a new home, buddy.
And if you're not on your email list, somehow get a hold of me if you want to be on an email list. And I'm going to put together some points.
I have one last question.
The other side.
Tanya, once he builds what he calls a driveway and we call a road, is it private access or public access?
I would think it would be, I think the question is who's going to maintain it, and I'm sure they'll volunteer to maintain it. You know?
He's going to claim public because part of his case is going to be we're enhancing this sanctuary
for people,
so the greater number of people can enjoy it.
It
you should be thanking us, not fighting us.
Is he going to have a gate at the end?
But it can't be private because it's through a public preserve.
Right.
There's no way it can be private,
so it
but
can't
maintenance.
Be gated off or anything.
No,
he has offered to put in two parking lots to appease the DEQ and
the parking lots are further damaged.
They are.
Yeah. More pavement.
But that way, it puts him higher up as far as public usage for his permit process.
And I'm on Facebook too, so Facebook or email if you have any questions.
Let's walk on down to the south property line. Art Smith, who was at one of the original signings when they had a strip of land which they sold to put in the barrier dunes. They went to sign, and then Baker Hamilton says that his brother, I guess it was Sheldon, did not want to sell his property. So this was left out. And the anticipation, I guess, would be that the township would come up with some funds later and buy it, et cetera. But somehow they never did, and the property then was sold to Bob Guzan and John Brooks and the rest of it.
There's a lot of, I didn't say a lot about the easement because I've heard so much that I'm not really sure what's accurate anymore, really. There's a lot of anecdotal information.
Sedoni Creek.
The green building up there, that's one of the original old buildings from the mouth. And it was always like Pine Bluff Resort, run by the Webbers, great German enclave, etc. Good family. They still have their whole hunk of land. And then there was a great lawsuit between Hamilton and the Webbers, which basically they thought they owned on this side, but somehow the court went to the Supreme Court, decided that somehow they didn't.
Oh.
And so
that's why they're only on that side.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
They paid taxes for years.
Yeah. So the north, that happens at the north property line, right?
No, this is the north property line.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
This is their property.
We're on Guzan property. We'd be over there.
This is it here.
All right.
Okay, let's clarify that then. Okay.
This is the north property.
This is the north property line, according to Bob.
The south property line would be right down in North Creek. So we're still not on their property. Now, I don't know if you heard me or not. These people, Smith and Nagels, insisted that their easement be aligned by
you. Okay.
You see all those pilings?
Yeah.
Those were from the logging days. That's when they used to walk along there and pull the logs.
Huh. They're still there.
So now we're paralleling the water, right, Bob?
Because it's down here, it will go along the water.
Okay, the reason that it comes down here is because Smith's
greenhouse
up there, and Nagel's had a 100-foot strip that they were
their easement went through, and when they bought the property, they insisted that their easement be along the bayou, which we call the bayou. So it's going to go along 100 foot, and then it's going to angle back to where we started. So it comes down to the bayou, goes 100 feet, and then it goes back up to the middle of the property. And that's the reason why it takes that jog. I mentioned back there that if they get the road permit, they are prepared to offer an alternative route that would be less offensive to the dunes. They're being nice guys.
Oh, okay.
Right back to where
wow, is that steep?
That is steep.
Yeah. Oh, this is where they would come.
So where what?
Right up this angle right here.
So now the road has to cut back up.
It cuts right up, right through there.
So that's one of his special permit areas. I mean, the slope here is pretty steep.
Well, with the new law, you don't have to worry about the slope. All you have to do is make sure that it doesn't cause erosion. And if you get a licensed engineer to sign off on the project, that's deemed enough. Enough.
Okay, back to the dune.
So this shows how the sand will move down over the road. And if you try to dig the road through that sand, it's just going to be covered all the time. It'll turn into a dune. Yeah, in place.
Thank you.